this morning, if you got your Bibles, go ahead and open them to Colossians chapter 4. We're in this year-long theme where we're asking God to transform us. And the way that you transform is not to change the way you think about you, but to change the way you think about God. And as we start to see Him in all of His goodness and all of His glory and all of His greatness, when we start to worship Him in that way, the Bible says He transforms us from one degree of glory to the next. He makes us look a little bit more like Jesus the more we see Him in all of His wonder and goodness. And so we've been going through the book of Colossians together because the book of Colossians is all about the superiority and the sufficiency of Jesus. How great, how awesome, how wonderful He is. And we've been asking God to transform our mindset, that we would see Jesus for His rightful place, that when we see Him in all of His glory and all of His wonder and all of His power, when we understand who He is, that He would start to change us and transform us. And so if you missed any of these, you can go on our website and you can click on our YouTube channel and make sure you watch all the sermons. It's been awesome to go through all the verses of Colossians together as a church family. We've talked about Jesus. Sometimes we play head games and we act like there is no king, but the reality is there is a king. And His name is Jesus. And the King has done everything required to bring you into His kingdom. And He longs for you to be so close to Him that you start to think like He thinks and act like He acts in every situation. So you carry out His agenda on the earth. But He's not just the King. He's the image of the invisible God. He's the firstborn of all creation. He is the head of the church. He's this mysterious treasure. You can never plumb the depths of Jesus. He's amazing. Look at what it says. Can you look for week three slide? Do you see that on there? First slide for week three. We talked about Jesus being the real deal. And we said, Jesus, you don't need more than Jesus because He's the real deal. And if you're trying to find a new deal, you're getting a raw deal because Jesus is the real deal. He's all that you need. In the church in Colossae, where they were being led by some false teachers, they said, hey, there's other ways. Like, once you get Jesus, that's wonderful, but there's other spiritual beings you can connect with. There's other angelic forces that you can unlock new levels of spirituality. And we said, no, Jesus, He's the real deal. He's done it all. He's canceled your debt. You remember the receipt spike? He's canceled your debt. He's paid it in full. He's the real deal. Week four, look at the next slide there for week four. We said, is your goal to see a better you or to reflect a clearer Jesus? And we talked about looking in the mirror. Every time we look in the mirror, is my goal today to see a better version of myself, like me 2.0, or to reflect a clearer picture of Jesus to the world? And then last week, we wrapped it up with week five. And it says, you always have a singular audience. Do you remember? Whatever you do in your marriage, whatever you do with kids, whatever you do at work, it's always for an audience of one. And every right will be rewarded, every wrong will be righted, either by Jesus or in Jesus. He's going to take care of it. And so Paul wraps up the book of Colossians in Colossians chapter 4 by bragging on some coworkers. Like, he has this time where he just says, hey, I just want to commend this co-laborer in Christ because they labor so hard on your behalf. They pray for you so often. They take the good news of Jesus around the world for you. And so I just kind of wanted to mirror Paul today, if we can. And I wanted to brag on some co-laborers in Christ. And so I'm going to welcome Zane and Candace Carney to the stage, and I want you to take a look at some video stuff of just a little of what they do in Belize. Some video continue to play in the background, but would you guys welcome Zane and Candace? Awesome. So this morning, they're just going to take a few minutes, and Candace is going to tell you a little bit about their story and how God moved them from here being business owners to leave everything and go to Belize to be missionaries. to labor for Jesus. And then Zane's going to tell you a little bit about some of the current things they have going on in Belize. My family's so excited. We're going down in October. And my kid's first ever international missions trip. And so we're going as a family. We just love these guys. We're so proud of what they're doing. Come on up, Myra. Yeah. Awesome. So you can bring the whole family up for just a minute. Like, just a minute. You want to? No, you don't want to? It's okay. It's all right. If you want to come, come. If you don't, it's totally okay. We're not going to. It's all good. We're so proud of what God is doing in and through Zane and Candace and the ministry at Kids Connect for Jesus. And so part of when you give, a little small portion of that goes to support the work that God's doing in Belize. But they're here to talk to you a little bit today about what God is doing, how you can be a part of the work. We have a team going during spring break, and we're hoping to take as many people as possible to come during spring break. Heather Phillips is in the Phillips family. Hannah, they're going to be organizing that. Would you just raise your hands real quick? Yeah, you can talk to them after the service if you'd like to know more. But go ahead, Candace.
Okay. So this is, our family plus Tucker over there. Solomon is 5, Myla is 4, and Tucker is 7. We moved to Belize almost 3 years ago. We're super normal people, I would like to think, and we didn't have any, we're not pastors, you know, or anything like that. So when we were sent to Belize to be missionaries, we were like, are you sure about this, Lord? Us? So, he definitely, without us even realizing it, has equipped us every step of the way to be able to do the work that he has called us to do down there. So it is really amazing to see how, it's really amazing to see that maybe things that we learned through the church along the way have been things that we've used down there and doing ministry and discipling and just coming alongside of people and just knowing how to be the church through being a part of a church for so long. So we came to Christ Community Church, 12 years ago or so, shortly after we were married. And so we were over, when they were at the school, we were a part of that. I was able to serve with the worship team, and Zane taught in the back. And it's amazing to just see how the Lord equipped us through being at this church, at this small, just relational church, so that we're able to really dig deep with people down there. So I feel like if I start telling the story about how we got there, I would be up here for 30 minutes.
We'd have to call Bojangles, yeah.
So I will let Zane go ahead and start telling you. I'll tell you a little bit about what Kids Connect. So Kids Connect for Jesus is who we do ministry with down there. They are an organization that pours into the southern part of Belize. We work within the schools doing ministry. We do teacher and principal training. We do medical clinics every 90 days to provide medicines and prescriptions to the locals. We do dental clinics, vision clinics, as well as just doing what's called family impact missions trips. So we actually have whole families come down and serve together. So it's a really beautiful picture to just see families all together in these schools, in these communities, in these churches, pouring, as a family and doing the Lord's work. We also have a feeding program with Rise Against Hunger. So we provide food to the schools so that they can have lunch programs for the students. We also have things that he's going to talk about. So here you go.
Very good. Well, good morning, church. Happy Sunday. We are wonderfully ecstatic to be here. We get a short break. We came in for a month this time, and you'd think that's a long time, but we're trying to schedule in a movie for the next 2 weeks, and we're looking for those 2 hours to do that. So it's really a whirlwind. So, well, thank you all for all your generous giving to us to allow us to go down there and be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ. It's a powerful thing. Down there, you have your ups and your downs, so having a church body like you guys to bounce stuff off of and to pick us up out of the mud when we're a little bit stuck is a huge thing. It's only a God thing. So So, yes, we are the Carneys. You know, there's a song, I guess, that says, I'd rather serve you in the jungle than not serve you at all. Well, that's exactly what we've done, and it is the jungle down there. Okay, so we moved down there going on 3 years ago, and our primary job was to kind of rehabilitate this retreat center that was purchased a couple years before we got there. And in the last several years, we've cleaned it up. The Lord's helped us restaff it in a way that we find people's passions and put them in the positions to where it's a long-term thing instead of a revolving door and a constant struggle to find staff. So happy to say that that's going beautiful now, that we can step away from that, that we feel like we've accomplished what the Lord's sent us down there to do immediately. Rolling over to our next biggest thing down there that the Lord's put us in, Christmas, we came back in January and immediately took over and managed their trade school. It's a small business center where we take individuals that have either been kind of kicked out of the fast lane of, or the lane of society down there, and said, hey, you're not, you caused too much trouble, or your reputation, we're not letting you through or giving you a chance. And so we take young men and women like that, single mothers with kids that just have really got nowhere else to go, and we bring them in, and through I guess the ministry and one-on-one discipling, we give them a chance to learn a trade, but then go out and feel confident that they can start their own small business to provide for their families. And so we're looking for that generational change more than teaching one man how to build something. We're looking for him to, ingest these trades and teach his family and others to develop a skill set for life. Along with, discipling is our number one focus. So we have to disciple there a little different than we would disciple here. It requires some headlocks and a little rougher love down there. But I think
you're perfectly suited for that.
He sent the right man for the job, so we've definitely had to do that.
So you can put him in the half smelly Nelson.
It works. It works every time. And those end up usually being my lead men is the ones that
awesome.
Give me the most the most trouble coming into it. So yeah, we want to just give God all the praise and honor for us doing what we've set out to do down there, and we absolutely 100% felt like that we are following in the Lord's footsteps down there. And it wasn't an easy road the last 3 years, but it's getting it's getting brighter and brighter, and it's filling us more and more knowing that we're right where we need to be.
That's awesome. Would you guys give it up for them? Don't leave yet. Don't leave yet. Yeah. So what they talked about doesn't even scratch the surface of what they do. Like, their job description is 18 pages long. I've never seen anything like it in my life. But they are so perfectly suited for this. Before they left, they were both entrepreneurs. They both had their own small businesses. And so God perfectly suited them for that. Zane's a blacksmith, knows how to do all, he can fix anything. He can make anything run. He was telling me about something that they found, an old piece of equipment out in the jungle that had been abandoned for like 7 years, brought it back, made it run again, and they're like, this is what a ditch witch does. Look at this. This is amazing. Now you don't have to dig. This is amazing. So he's perfectly suited. So they do trade school, but they also do hydroponics and aquaponics and fish farm, all kinds of stuff. They're trying to help people know how to live, not just for a handout, but a hand up, so that they can go on with their lives. There's been generational, transformational change already. The village that they do life in, before, only one person in the church was a man. It was the pastor.
Yep.
And Zane and Candace started going, now their church is predominantly men. Mm-hmm. And that brings huge generational change there in that community. He was telling me about this one guy that they check on. He's 92 years old. And he's a candidate, potentially. He had been asking for prayer because he can't see, he's blind. And one of their medical teams may be able to do a cataract surgery for him. They're praying for him. But they go and check on him, and there's not the same level of care there. Like, so he's 90-some years old. He's in a hammock all day, every day. It's in his house. He can't get up. He can't move. He can't walk around. He has people who take care of him. They take off for days at a time. And so Zane and Candace go in and check on him. Hey, how you doing? And his door is padlocked, so nobody can get in and steal the stuff from the house. So Zane jumps through the window, and he feeds him. And then he puts another piece of pizza in his hand because he's been laying in the hammock for 2 days. And then they pray together. And it amazed me as we talked at lunch, this guy's request was, hey, can we sing When the Roll's Called Up Yonder?
Every time.
Like every time. That's what he cares about, this 90-year-old believer in Jesus. He doesn't care he's been abandoned by his family. He cares that Jesus with skin on is there, so they're going to celebrate and sing. And so, I mean, that's one story. They do feeding programs in the schools. They teach Bible in schools. They actually teach the Bible. The public schools say, come in and teach our kids Bibles.
Yep.
It's amazing. They do medical. I mean, it's unbelievable the amount of stuff that you guys are doing. And I just want to say, they do it on far less than anybody I've ever seen. And they won't ask you for money, but I'm asking you to partner with them and support them. Because they need finances to be able to do this. One of their big needs right now, they need health and evacuation insurance because they're in the middle of the jungle. They're the pharmacy, right? And so it's 90 days between people who come in, right, for medical missions. And so Candace was telling me that one of the kids came in with a shovel to the face the other day, right, like head split open, and she thought that he had lost an eye. And in that moment, they're like, what will we do? Like literally, we can't get back home. We don't have the evacuation insurance. And so right now, it's because all their funds that they don't get a salary at all from Kids Connect for Jesus. Every bit of support that they raise, it goes to help support Kids Connect for Jesus and the ministry and the mission. And what little bit is left, that's what they live on. And so they really would love to be able to, if they have a medical emergency, be able to fly to medical care. And that's such a reasonable, small thing. And so look, think of it like this. If 50 families said, we're going to give up one meal at Chick-fil-A in a whole month, right? Like just $20 every month. I mean, that'd be $1,000 extra a month. They could more than take care of their medical insurance, and then they'd have a little bit left over to start some new projects. So I just want you to know, I'm not asking you to do something that we don't do. It's the joy of our life after we give to the Lord here, that every month we get to support Katie and I and our family, our girls. We pray for them every single night, that the Lord would bless them and the work that they're doing there. And we support them every month because it's the best work that I know. It's the best work that I know. And so as you leave today, I'm going to try not to get emotional. I'm just so proud of you guys. So as you leave today, there's a computer on the back counter. Or you can go on your phone right now to Kids Connect for Jesus, Kids Connect for Jesus, and you can click on the donate button. You can sign up for monthly sponsorship for them. That's really what they need, is some monthly sponsor. You can do it for any level. You can do it for $5 a month. They don't care. They had somebody do that, right? $5 a month, and they were like so excited about that somebody believed enough to say, hey, we can give up $5 a month. But what you're doing when you support them is you're supporting the work of a 90-year-old guy sitting in a hammock singing, When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder, I'll Be There. You're supporting a kid that, a teenager that everyone else gave up on. And now they know Jesus, and they have a trade, and they can support a family. It's an amazing, amazing thing. So I just want to say, if the Holy Spirit leads you at all to do it, do it. Do it today. KidsConnectForJesus.org, and you can click on donate, and then it says support our team. And then you have to scroll all the way to the bottom because it has Z for Zane, Zane Carney. So go all the way to the bottom of the donate button, click it, and for monthly support. Hannah, you're going to be back there. You'll help them, right? Okay, fantastic. Good stuff. Would you give it up for the Carneys? Awesome. Love you guys. So proud of them and the work God's doing through them. All right, so I'm going to have a message for 5 minutes. Let's do this. Yeah, Colossians chapter 4. And before we leave the service, we're going to pray for Zane and Candace. Prayer is so important. That's my message today. Prayer makes all the difference. I love the story of George Mueller. Do you guys know him? Anybody, if you've never read stories about George Mueller, this guy is unbelievable, the stuff that the Lord did through this family. He was a guy who believed in those that were less fortunate, just like Zane and Candace do. And they totally changed the landscape of an entire population of people. He ran a church that had over 1,200 people that were a part of it. He ran a printing press Track/Bible Printing Press Society. He ran five orphanages, and his deal was he was just going to pray. And every time there was a need, he would just pray. And he knew that the Lord would provide through prayers. And there's these revolutionary stories, I love it, of him coming down, and there's literally nothing to eat in the orphanage for the kids. Literally nothing. There's, I mean, you know, you're doing stuff on a shoestring, and there's literally nothing for the kids to eat. And he tells the people to set the places at the table. And then he brings these friends in, and he's already been up in prayer, and he says, gather around the table, children, for our breakfast, and there's literally no breakfast. And he tells them all to grab hands, and he prays, and he says, Lord, we know that you're a father who knows what his children need. And we know that these children can't do school today and learn on empty stomachs. And so we thank you for the breakfast that you're going to provide. In Jesus' name, amen. What a prayer of faith, right? As soon as he finished praying, there was a knock on the door. And there were these guys carrying in these big baskets full of bread. And it was a baker. He said, Reverend Mueller, the Lord woke me up at 2 o'clock in the morning and said, these orphans don't have anything to eat at the orphanage today. Get your workers and go to the bakery and bring it by. As he was finishing speaking and they're ushering in all the bread, there's another knock at the door, and it was a milk wagon. The milk wagon says, Reverend Mueller, I just want you to know that we've had a flat. Like, you don't get a flat on a wagon, but you know what I'm saying. Like, the wagon is broken down. I'm going to have to unload all of this milk to be able to fix the wagon. It's too heavy to fix with the milk inside. Can the orphans use some milk today? And so they unloaded all the milk. So that morning for breakfast, they had milk and bread. Now, what would happen in our lives if we trusted our Father in prayer like that? If we knew that we were going to be wrestlers in prayer on behalf of not just our own lives, but the needs of other people around us, what would happen? Can you imagine with me what it would look like to have a church full of people who prayed and trusted Jesus like that? That would be incredible, wouldn't it? Well, this is what the Apostle Paul describes in Colossians chapter 4. He's wrapped up all of his stuff about the greatness of Jesus, and he has this one last reminder, and it's to pray. Look at what it says, Colossians chapter 4, verse 2. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. He says, I want you to persevere to the point of devotion. I want you to associate closely, to always be at the disposal, devote yourself persistently to prayer until people think it's your hobby. He said, that's what I want you to do. And not just sort of like average, like, thank you for this food, bless it to the nourishment of our bodies and our bodies to your service, right? Like, it's not just those kind of prayers, but it's this constant attitude of prayer that you're constantly aware that there's a king and that he has an agenda in the world, and you're listening for what he would have you do and what he would have you say, because everywhere you go, you want to reflect this clearer picture of Jesus to a world who so desperately needs to see him. So you're always locked in, listening to the king. You're always locked in, talking to the king about whatever you see. You're persisting in prayer all the time. Look at what he says. You're watching with thankfulness. You don't have to thank God. Listen to me. You don't have to thank God for every circumstance. Aren't you grateful? That's not a command. But you have to thank God in every circumstance. In the middle of everything, you can still give thanks. I want you to write this one little sentence down today. Maybe you just want to jot it down. You can take a picture on the slide if you want. But let your prayers reflect your real reality. Let your prayers reflect your reality. Like, there's sometimes I think we pretend God doesn't know that we're upset. Right? I mean, there's times we pretend like, I couldn't really be honest with God about how I'm feeling right now. He might get upset with me. He knows exactly how you're feeling anyway. Let your prayers reflect your reality. He says, but at the same time, like, continue in it with thanksgiving. Like, you can be thankful even if you're mad. You can be thankful even if you're sad. Like, write this down. But also let your prayers reflect the greatest reality. And here's the greatest reality. There's a king, and he can do more than you can ever dream or imagine. There's nothing he's not capable of. All power is at his disposal. All resources are at his disposal. All ability is at his disposal. All peace, every single thing that you would ever need for life is at his disposal. And so, yes, pray prayers that reflect your current reality, but then pray prayers that remember the greatest reality. Like, yes, marriage is really difficult right now. But you know what? I'm going to be married with Jesus forever. Yes, you know what? Life is hard with this kid right now. But you know what? They're not going to be a kid for long. God's going to get me through this season with this kid, and he's going to give me every bit of wisdom that I need because his word promises it. Listen to me. Some of us are praying for rescue. And that's not a bad prayer to pray, but it's not the greatest prayer that you could pray. Look at what Paul says. He keeps going with the next verse. At the same time, pray also with us. Read this with me. What does it say? That God may what? Open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I'm where? Where is he? As he's writing about being thankful in prayer, where is he? As he's like chained up in a prison, talking about, hey, when you pray, make sure you're thankful. Like he's in the middle of prison because he's told people about Jesus, right? And what does he say? He's like, I'm not praying that you rescue me. I'm not praying for some giant rescue from this. Here's what I want you to pray. I want you to pray a bigger prayer than that. I want you to pray for an open door so that even in prison I can tell people about Jesus. Listen to me. Some of us are praying for rescue. That's not a bad prayer. Like, Lord, rescue me from this relationship. God, rescue me from this depression. God, rescue me from this mindset. God, rescue me from these physical ailments. God, rescue me from my financial situation. Listen, that's not a bad prayer. You can pray that all day long. But sometimes a prayer better than God, rescue me, is God, in the midst of this terrible circumstance, would you open a door so I can reflect who you are, how great you are, in the middle of a junky day, in the middle of a terrible day, in the middle of a hard relationship, in the middle of a terrible tragedy. God, my prayer isn't that you rescue me from it, but my prayer is even bigger than that, to reflect this greatest reality. Would you just help me to have an open door in the middle of the tough day? Do you see it? Paul doesn't say, hey, I'd like to get all the believers together. Could you get together and let's have a prayer session to get me out of prison? And now they did that for Peter, right? And Peter got out. That was an amazing thing, but Paul doesn't ask him to. He's like, hey, if you're going to pray for me, here's what you pray. You don't pray that I get rescued out of my circumstance. You pray I reflect Jesus in the middle of my circumstance. That's crazy. Look what he says. He keeps talking about prayer. He says, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of your time. Let your speech always be hateful. Is that what it should be? Right? Like, especially on Twitter. No, let it be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer every person. Like, how many of you have ever seen Salt Bae? You know what I'm talking about? You know who Salt Bae is? Nobody? Doggone it. All right, there's this guy on the internet, and his name is Salt Bae. Man, you got to bone up on your culture, people. Like, all right, this guy, he's got a ponytail. He's a buff guy. He's got, like, a dark complexion. He's a restaurateur, right? And so at the end of his thing, he's famous all over the internet because he takes a massive wad of salt and then he sprinkles it like this onto the thing, but it bounces off his gigantic forearms onto the stuff people are about to eat. And somehow he's famous. Only in America. Only in America. Right? But here's the thing. Here's what happens. The Apostle Paul says, in every situation, even while I'm in prison, every person I talk to, every relationship, every parenting thing, every friendship thing, every kid thing, wherever I am, here's my prayer. God, would you give me an open door to say whatever it is you want to say so that I reflect who you are? That's my prayer. God, in this conversation with my spouse where I'm really frustrated and really upset, like, my prayer is not that I'm right, that I win and they lose. My prayer is that you would open a door so that I could show them how great you are. My prayer as I'm talking to my kid, right, is not, God, would you just let them see how crazy disrespectful they are and how wonderful as a parent I am. And no, that's it. Would you just help me have an open door to reflect who you are, the greatness of Jesus, in the middle of this open door so that I can showcase who you are, your grace, and your truth. See, here's the problem. Like Paul says, let your speech in every situation, even with people you don't like, let it be full of grace, seasoned with truth. That's what he says. Now, we do it the opposite way. Like, we're like Salt Bae, you know, let me sprinkle some truth on you. Do you know what you did to me today? And it's like, just a season of grace, right? Like this is, Paul flips it. He's like, no, in every situation, full of the grace of God, reflecting the grace of God. Drizzle it with truth, right? Now here's the deal. Like if you have all grace with no truth, there's no transformation, right? That's what people want in our culture. Full of grace, no truth. If you have all truth, you're just like salting that thing up, and no grace, then all you do is come across as a hateful jerk. Okay? Full of grace, sprinkle of truth. That's what makes an impact. He says, look at what he says the next verse. Skip down to verse 12. He says, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you. He's the one who planted the church there. Look at what he says. Look at this description. Wouldn't you want to be described this way? This is crazy. Look what he said. He's always struggling on your behalf in prayer. Do you do that for anybody? Do you battle for other people? I mean, there's some of you who are great at it. You're naturals at it. That's how God's gifted you. But there's others of us, like, that's foreign to us. I mean, he's always wrestling, not for himself. He's wrestling in prayer for these other people. Look what he says, that you may stand, how? Mature, fully assured in the will of God. For I bear witness, he's worked so hard for you and for those in Laodicea as well. He's all the time battling in prayer for other people so that they know Jesus and they love one another and they live as the church, so they're unshakable. That's what he's, so they're fully rooted down. No matter what cancer comes in their life, no matter what hardship comes in their life, no matter what happens in their marriage, no matter what happens with their kids, no matter what happens with their bodies, no matter what happens with their finances, they are steadfast and immovable. They are rock solid because they're so down deep into Jesus, they can't be moved. He says he's all the time praying for you so that you get there. He's all the time praying for you so that you get there. Would that be a drastic change in your prayer life? It would be for me, right? Well, this week, we're praying and believing that God is going to start that in all of us. And he's going to do it in a special way. Today, we launched this brand new thing, and it's called Imagine. It's called Imagine. And if you notice, there's two words that are highlighted inside of Imagine. What is it? I'm in, right? So for the past 2.5 years, we've been imagining what it would be like to have a new place, to have a new facility, to have this place that's big enough where people don't have to park across the street and walk across with the sheriff, where you don't have to elbow people in here or actually be able to talk with people after a church service in a hallway with like, I got to get my kids, get out of the way, right? You know what I'm saying? Right? We've been praying and imagining and dreaming of what it's like, and I'm here to tell you, I believe that God is saying it's time for us to stop dreaming and to say, I'm in. To say, I'm in. And so for the next 7 weeks, we're going to have this campaign of prayer. A campaign of prayer. Because there's a real reality. And the reality is we have all of the plans. That's an awesome thing. We have all of the permits. That's an amazing thing. Like from the city of Mooresville, we're good to go. We have all of the stuff for the contractor. Everything is good to go. You know what we don't have? The finances. That's it. It's just money. That's it. That's the only thing that's left. The people laugh. Like I tell people that all the time. I'm like, the only thing we don't have is the money. So it's no big deal, right? And people laugh about it. You don't have the money. That's the biggest part. It's like, no, that's the smallest part. That's the smallest part for God. You know why? Because he owns it all. He owns it all. He owns every single thing. He's not limited to just like the 400 people of us that are here that say, this is my church. He's not limited with that. Like, are you serious? Like in our past as a church, God's used people who don't even go here, who have said, I see that God's transformed people's lives here. I want to be a part of that. So we're not going to pray small prayers. Like, we've got all the plans. We've got all the stuff. The land is paid off. I'm actually renting on it right now. Like, I mowed it yesterday. It was amazing. 2.5 hours on the mower with God. It was awesome, right? It was an amazing thing. We're ready to go. It's just the money, and it's just money. And so we need to pray. We need to pray because we serve a big God. What would happen if we started to wrestle for the needs of people in our community? You know, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people who don't know Jesus within just 5 miles of right here. You don't have to go far. And we have this place. We have this moment. And so this is the moment for us to stop imagining and say, I'm in. So in 7 Sundays, September 29th, we're praying that the Lord would do something bigger than he's ever done before. We're believing for a one-day offering that's bigger than anything we could ever imagine, because he's at work. And so for us, that might mean, like, saving for the next 7 weeks. It might mean, like, selling something that we have. When we sold our house, Katie and I just sold our house, and we knew that this was coming because I get a preview before you. And so as we're talking to God, we're like, okay, God, when we sell our house for a profit, what is it that you want us to give to this? Like, instead of rolling it into the next house, or instead of, like, what would you have us do? Because we believe people's lives need to be transformed. And I don't know if you've looked around, we're kind of limited with how much more we can grow here. And so we want to be a part of it. And so we're saying, okay, God, we want to stop imagining, saying, I'm in. So maybe you need to sell something. Maybe you need to save something. Maybe you just need to pray that God would lead somebody outside of our body to do something. Because on September 29th, we launched this 6-month social media campaign with this awesome video that a guy in our church has shot, where we're asking other churches to partner with us, where we're asking other believers to partner with us. And so maybe you just pray that God would do something there. But we're praying the Lord would raise $1 million. It's just $1 million. He can do that. That's nothing to him. And we'd be ready to go. In the next 12 months, we'd be able to get the loan. We'd be able to break ground. We'd be able to start. And so would you partner along with me in praying? Because our God can do more than we can ever imagine, right? And we need to battle on other people's behalf, because I just want to tell you, there are marriages that are dying in our city. And there are teenagers that are going through insane times in our city. And there's kids who are growing up who don't know Jesus in our city. And there's people who moved here from all over the country, and they don't know a soul, and they're looking for community in our city, right? And it's time for us to say, I'm in. And so here's what I want you to do. The ushers are going to come forward right now. And everybody that's got a smartphone, pull it out right now. You ready? Here's what I want you to do. Ephesians 3:20 is my life verse. I love it. And here's what it says. Praise be to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask or imagine, according to the power that's at work in us through Jesus Christ. Praise be to him and glory in his church forever. And so we're praying, God, would you do something more than we can imagine? This can't happen with just us. It can't. But with you, you can do it all. When all of us are like Epaphras's and we're praying and battling in prayer over the next 7 weeks, I'm believing God's going to do something that knocks our socks off, that everybody would say, man, they're not smart enough to pull that off. Man, they're not big enough to pull that off. Man, they're not rich enough to pull that off. They just don't have that kind of finances. But God does, right? And so we're praying, Lord, would you do more than we can imagine? From 3:20 to 3:21 every day. Every day. 3:20 to 3:21. So here's what I want you to do. Pull out your smartphone, put an alarm, and then go ahead and set it. Add alarm, and then do 3:20. If you're super spiritual, put AM. I'm just kidding. Don't do that. That's really rude. 3:20 PM, hit save. All right? And then I want you to set it every day for the next 7 Sundays. Every day. Every day. And then the ushers, go ahead and pass these out. There's these little dots, and they're annoying as all get out, and they're supposed to be. Here's what I want you to do. I put one on my watch at the little 20-minute hand, right? I put it on my watch, so every time I look at it, it'll come off. Don't worry. Like, it's not bonded to your iWatch forever, right? But I want you to take one of these. They're cut out. Just take one, and if you have FFS, fat finger syndrome, like I do, I could barely get it on. Find a child, and they'll help you, okay? Find an infant. They'll be able to pull it off. They'll be able to put it where you want them to go. These are very small stickers. But I want it to be annoying. You know why? Because I want things that irritate us are great reminders, right? And so every day, as you look at your watch, at the 20-minute mark, would you just say, God, would would you help me to say I'm in? Would you show me what you want me to do to be a part of it? And would you do through all of us and people outside of our body, would you do more than we could ever imagine so that people's lives are transformed? People's lives are transformed. That's what it's all about. 3:20 to 3:21. Ephesians 3:20 to 3:21. Every day. And then be ready September 29th for God to do something miraculous. Would you pray with me? Maybe there's somebody in this house today that you've been praying for rescue. And listen, we'll partner alongside of you in praying for that. We'll pray that God transform your spouse's heart, that God transforms your teenager's attitude, or that God transforms your work situation and gives you a better job. Like, I'll pray for all of that right alongside of you. But maybe instead of praying for rescue, maybe a bigger prayer is, God, in the middle of this, help me reflect your greatness. I mean, let your prayers reflect your reality, but always filter them through the greatest reality. We serve a God who is the King. He's the King. He's the real deal. He's the image of the invisible God. He's the firstborn. He's the head of the church. He's this mysterious treasure. He's the real deal, and we just want to reflect him. Wherever we are, we want to reflect his greatness. And so for some of us, maybe we need to flip our prayers a little bit. Still let them reflect our reality. But maybe we say, God, would you reflect the greatest reality of who you are in the midst of this hardship, in the midst of this tough marriage, in the midst of this tough season of parenting, that I would be like this mirror reflecting to everyone around me that you're real. I mean, there's some of us in the house today that our prayer life is just really weak. I can say that's me sometimes. I just get so busy and so distracted. I'm not constantly aware of his presence and constantly listening. Listen, what would happen if we were all like Epaphras, battling for everybody we know? Lord, would you help them? I know they're struggling in this marriage. Would you help them be so rooted, so deep down in you that no matter what the enemy throws at them today, it bounces off of them like Teflon? Like they repel it because they're rooted so deeply in you. God, I pray for that teenager today that no matter what temptation comes in their life, they would see you're so much better than anything the world has to offer. Let them be so rooted deep down in you and so aware of your presence that even the best things the world has to offer them today don't look like anything compared to the joy that you give them. What would happen if we were wrestling on behalf of, Lord, I know my neighbors don't know you. God, more than a new raise or more than a better car, they need to know forgiveness that comes from you. God, what if we wrestled on behalf? And then I would love for all of us to commit to wrestle in prayer, to say, God, what would my part be on September 29th? God, would you do more than we could ever imagine? As we all say, I'm in. Lives are transformed. Lord, would you do that in this house? Start it in us. We're desperate for you. And all God's people said, amen. Before you leave, take a look at this video.
Good morning, Christ Community Church. Hey, my name is Mac, and I just have a few things that I wanted to keep you in the loop on. First things first, just a friendly reminder that our backpack ministry collection item for August is going to be Pop-Tarts. So, if you have any Pop-Tarts that you'd like to donate, you can go ahead and drop those off in the collection box in the foyer. Your donation is greatly appreciated, and it makes a huge impact. Next, we're having a Next Steps class this evening at 5:30 p.m. So what a Next Steps class is if you're interested in joining the church family, or maybe you just have a few more questions about what we believe here at Mooresville, Pastor David Teague is going to be here at the church again at 5:30 p.m. to be able to answer any questions that you might have or provide any direction that you might want. So If you're interested in this class, go ahead and write next steps in the back of your response card and how many kids that you have that will need childcare. Next, men, if you've been searching for a place where you can grow in fellowship as iron sharpens iron, there's a place for you. So on Saturday, August 24th at 7:30 a.m. at Corrine's Cafe at the intersection of 150 and 115, there's going to be a men's fellowship meeting. This is exactly the place for you. If you have any more questions, go ahead and call or text David Frale at 845-532-1433. You're not going to want to miss it. Well, that's all I have for you guys this week. If you want more information, go to cccmooresville.com. But wait, there's more. Check this video out.